I'm Akis Papadopoulos. I'm working as a researcher in CERTH. That's a research center in northern Greece, in Thessaloniki. I'm heading the media verification team. We are developing technologies that are helpful in verifying the authenticity of images and videos online. And we are, of course, a partner in the WeVerify project. I will try to summarize in this short presentation some background knowledge on the area, on the emerging area of deepfakes, and also our experience in building the deepfake detection service for the project. Unless you've been living under a rock for the last 5 years, I guess you are familiar with deepfakes. I'll just repeat some basic information here. Typically, deepfakes are used to refer to content that's generated by deep neural networks and seems authentic to the human eye. In general, it started from a specific type of generated content some years ago, but nowadays people use it in a much broader sense and refer to almost any kind of synthetic content as long as part of it is generated by deep neural networks. In most cases that we see on the internet, we see deepfakes focused on the face, and there are, broadly speaking, four types of deepfakes around face. So those that have to do with the entire face synthesis, those that have to do with attribute manipulation or editing. Third category is about the so-called face swaps or identity swaps or replacement. And last but not least, face expression swap or face reenactment. The area is definitely gaining a lot of attention recently. We are seeing an explosion in the number of papers in conferences and journals. Here, just two indicative diagrams showing the number of papers on the left mentioning GANs. It's a very popular model for generating synthetic images, the so-called generative adversarial networks. At the right hand side, papers that mention the term deepfakes. And in both cases, we see that there is an exponential growth. Also, in terms of deepfake quality, we can see a very impressive improvement over the last years. Here, it's a relatively dated image, which shows the really impressive quality improvement since 2014, when the first GAN model was proposed by Ian Goodfellow, until 2018. When already the results are quite impressive in terms of quality. And this is a more recent example with Tom Cruise deepfake that was posted on a TikTok account. It was actually created by a video effects specialist, Chris Hume. And when it appeared, it caused a lot of impression because it could not be detected by any of the commercial deepfake detection services. And also experts could not really tell whether it was an authentic video or not. The creator himself actually said that it took quite some effort to create, and also a lot of skills. He was an expert after all, but also an impersonator, so a person who looked like Tom Cruise a bit. So at this moment, this type of realism really requires skill and time, but perhaps we are not far from having these aspects automated as well. Here, these are some indicative examples of the kinds of deep learning architectures that are used under the hood for generating deep fakes. Perhaps the most well-known are the so-called encoder-decoder architectures or the generative adversarial networks, which I mentioned before. And there are some very popular extensions like cycle guns, pix2pix. There are also recursive neural network architecture and recently transformer architectures. It's really a field with impressive growth and advances. There is a very nice survey by Mirsky and Lee that really covers a lot of the recent ground. And in addition to the core deep learning models, there is also a whole pipeline and several tools involved in generating convincing deep fakes. There are several pre-processing steps. There is, of course, the core generation part and several post-processing steps, including detection of the face area, masking, landmark detection, and blending. So, for instance, what you see now in the zoom camera that combines my face with the background image, this is also part of this pipeline. And there are both open source tools like FaceSwap and DeepFace Lab, but of course, professional ones like Adobe Premiere. In the majority of cases, when we're talking about the so-called poor man's deepfakes, it is still possible to manually inspect and understand that we're talking about deepfakes. Here is a very nice and informative guide by Associated Press. It points to several cues that we should be looking for as manual inspectors. But as we said, the field is growing fast and we will not be able to rely on manual inspection for too long. Therefore, we need also automated methods. And here I try to summarize the main categories of deepfake detection methods. Really, the literature is vast. The recent survey listed more than 100 detection methods. We can broadly classify them, at least the main categories, into four, let's say, classes. One is based on physiological signals, so trying to, for instance, see issues with the blinking in the eyes or the inconsistencies in corneal specular highlights, or they try to apply photoplethysmography to estimate the pulse rate on a human subject. There are other methods that try to detect artifacts like the ones that human inspectors and examiners could find, like blurry areas around ears or mouth. There are methods that are purely deep learning based, the so-called CNN, convolutional neural network based approaches, like MesoNet, ExceptionNet, and so forth. And methods relying on spectral analysis, so analysis in the frequency domain. Our approach in WeVerify belongs to the third category, CNN-based approach, and I will provide more details in the next few minutes. We started the R&D activities on this service, to build the service, already in the end of 2019. At the same time, the well-known deepfake detection challenge was announced by the partnership on AI, and we registered for it. We saw it as a learning exercise, and it really was very helpful for us. The challenge ended in April last year, and our solution was ranked among the top 5% of the more than 2,000 solutions that were submitted there. And we internally released the service to the project. We verify in summer 2020, and with the very helpful feedback of our media partners, AFP and Deutsche Welle, we tested it and improved it over more than four evaluation cycles. And we are now at the stage where we are thinking of releasing it also to a broader public. Here is a sneak preview of how it looks like. This is our own interface, and you can select an image and you can see the detected faces and the score, the deep face score for each of those. And of course, you can also enter videos. There is a shot segmentation, and for each shot, you can see the detected faces. And for each face, you can see the deep fake detection score in red if it is high, in white if it is low. And also you can see each of the faces in the successive keyframes. You will see actually a demo of this integrated in the Truly Media by our partners at ATC tomorrow. Here is how it works under the hood. We take as input images or videos. There is a pre-processing step, the application of a deep learning model, and a post-processing step. In the case of videos, which is the more complicated case, there is quite a lot happening in the pre-processing. There is shot segmentation, many frames per shot used for analysis, a face detection step, face filtering for removing very small faces, face clustering per shot, and also some kind of filtering based on the clusters. Then we use a trained deep learning model. We are using an ensemble of models, so not a single model, but a combination of them based on state-of-the-art architectures like EfficientNet and Transformers. We largely relied on the Deepfake Detection Challenge dataset for training, but we are going to enrich this with examples we find in the wild. And thanks to these models, we produce deepfake scores for each face. And then we essentially combine these scores based on the clusters that we created before, the face clusters, and also we take into account the video shots in order to produce the results, and we provide them to the user interface. So here is again how the results look like for images. Here you can see a composite image. On the left hand side, you can see the authentic image, and on the right hand side, the deep fake face. And it was correctly flagged on the left as non-deep fake and on the right as a deep fake. And here is how the results look like for the video. At the top part, you can see the input video, then the detected shots, only one in this case, and then the detected faces in the video and the associated deepfake scores per face. And at the bottom, the intensity scale from white to red and the overall deepfake score based on the maximum deepfake score in the video. There is also a possibility to get into more depth and see for each of the faces the specific shot and the successive keyframes per shot in order to get into more detail. Here are some examples of successful image detection. These are all coming from well-known deepfakes on the internet. So in these particular cases, we correctly detected both deepfakes and non-deepfakes. Here are some limitations. For instance, we couldn't detect the example with Tom Cruise. It was a really well-made example, and also it involved a lot of manual post-processing and tuning. So it's a very challenging case. And also another limitation of our existing version is that we don't detect fully synthetic faces like faces created by sites like this person does not exist, but it's in our plans to do so. Here are some a couple of successful video examples. In the left side, correctly detected deepfake, and on the right hand side, a correctly detected non-deepfake, so correctly not detected. And here are also some challenges in videos, especially in videos with low quality or videos where faces appear with low resolution or smaller size. Those are typically confuse our classifiers, but we are continuously working on refining such issues. So we are, as I said, in the process of continuously improving the service in terms of efficiency, stability, also gathering feedback from our partners to improve the user interface and the usability. The service is already integrated in Truly Media and will soon be also available through the WeVerify plugin, which is already used by so many people around the globe. And if any of you is interested to test this, don't hesitate to get in touch. Here is my contact details and also on Twitter if you want to get in touch. And thank you a lot for your attention. I would be happy to take questions if there is time.
Thank you very much, Akis, for your presentation.